The session outline is Introduction to Cognitive Theories. At the end of this session, you will be able to discuss the cognitive theories of learning. Cognitive theories are also called Gestalt theories. Gestalt is not the name of any psychologist. Gestalt means pattern. As you can see in the picture, they are individually seen just geometrical figures. But when you look at them as a whole, you can see the pattern which emerges as a result of understanding the relation between the different parts. You can give meaning to the group of those geometrical figures as that of a face. This is possible when you see the situation as a whole. Therefore, the theories, cognitive theories, are also called Gestalt theories, because understanding the whole situation will result in patterns which are not the mere sum of a whole, but much more than the whole. And these theories are also called field theories or cognitive theories. And this perception of this figure as face is possible because the mind has been actively analyzing the individual parts and again synthesizing them in a way meaningful to us. In this way, the mind groups the sensory data in different ways and organizes information which is meaningful to us. And once we understand the pattern that emerges in the whole situation, a sudden awareness of the correct situation occurs, which we call as insight. That sudden awareness is called learning, as according to cognitive theories. It is also called field theories because the field involves the learner with all his perceptual abilities, the learning situation which provides the background, and the object which is being perceived. For example, the perception of a situation depends on the background. The figure ground theory of perception says that we perceive a particular object in the light of its background. For example, if you are drinking a liquid sitting in your home on a dining table, that may be perceived as you drinking water, whereas if you are drinking the same water in a bar, people may perceive you as drinking wine. Similarly, the objects can be perceived differently by the person depending upon the background, perceptual background. Thus, the field involves the learner, the learning object, and the learning situation, which interact so as to result in a kind of understanding. And therefore, these theories are called field theories. Mind plays a very important role in this kind of learning. Perception and concept formation are the results of learning. I think it is necessary for us to delve a few moments understanding what is perception and what is concept formation. We all get information from our sense organs about this world. We call them as mere sensations. But the moment we are able to interpret them as certain things, then they become perceptions. For example, pure sensation is known only to a small child. Bright light, a loud sound means nothing to a child. But for all of us, our previous experience helps us to interpret the information we get from the sense organs. For example, we are able to interpret a sound as the school bell or the alarm bell or the temple bell. Similarly, we are able to identify some smell as that of the pickle or of plow. So, this kind of immediate interpretation of the sensation is called perception. In this world, we get information about so many things around us through our sense organs, and we make meaning of those sensations by interpreting them as different things in the light of our previous experience. This is called perception. Perception is sensation plus meaning. If you are able to describe something, oh, this is sea, these are waves, this is a mountain, what are we doing exactly? We are perceiving the things. Then what is a concept? An idea about something which you have already perceived is a concept. That is, perception is the basis of concept formation. For example, we get to see and know that this is a mountain, these are plants, these are trees. But when someone mentions about a tree or a mountain, if you are able to get an idea of that, that is concept. A concept is a generalized statement about a class of things. When I say a table, no specific table will come in front of your eyes. You will get an idea of a general table. Similarly, that of a mountain. No specific mountain, but the generalized idea. So concepts are generalized ideas about a class of things, and they need language to define them. Let's go back to cognitive theories. So this perception and concept formation are necessary to see the situation, that is, perceive the situation and interpret it meaningfully. So whenever we see a particular situation, we try to make meaning of it. Even when we see a modern art, we try to see shapes and figures familiar to us. Even when we see a sky with clouds, we try to interpret the clouds in the shape of a chariot or like herd of a cattle or whatever. So we are able to understand a situation only when we look at it as a whole. Therefore, the analytical aspect and the reasoning of mind plays a very important role in this kind of learning. Then, what happens in this kind of learning? We are not able to see any observable changes in the behavior. So, what exactly happens when we learn? Whatever we learn gets organized into a whole thing in our mind that is called a perceptive mass or cognitive structure. In other words, whatever we learn does not get accumulated as facts and figures and do not get compartmentalized in our brain, but in fact, all this information gets organized into a general knowledge of which consists of language, images, etc. What happens when we learn something new? The already existing cognitive structure accommodates this new learning, and the whole cognitive structure gets reorganized into newer and better holes. For example, in lower classes, children are told that plants make their food on their own using sunlight and water, and we call this as photosynthesis. But in the higher classes, they get to learn photosynthesis and the chemical reactions which happen in detail as light reaction, dark reaction, etc. Now, whatever is learnt in higher class does not get sort of patched up in the cognitive structure, but in fact, the concept of photosynthesis gets reorganized so as to accommodate even this new information about the chemical reactions, the light reaction and the dark reaction. In this way, with more and more exposure and experience, we learn to accommodate the new knowledge to the existing cognitive structure, because of which our perceptive mass or the cognitive structure becomes a better whole. In other words, learning by this method involves perceptual reorganization. In this kind of learning, one does not understand the situation until he or she understands the connection between the different parts. I can compare this kind of learning to a game of chess, in which the player will not make a move unless he understands the situation in the light of the position of all the different pawns in that. So, another example can be perceiving the clouds in a clear sky, where we can see many familiar shapes. In fact, people came out with different constellations and named them by grouping the stars in the sky as Saptarshi and others. And this also involves grouping sensory data which in meaningful ways that are familiar to us. Once we group such data into meaningful patterns, then learning suddenly happens. And that sudden awareness or insight, so to say, happens so suddenly, which can be compared to that wow, aha feeling. But the understanding of the situation takes a lot of time. So, once a person views the situation as a whole, understands the connection or the organization in that particular situation, then the insight into that situation occurs suddenly. And once that happens, it is relatively permanent. Since it is permanent and since the knowledge is understood, it can be used in variety of situations. That is, application of that knowledge is possible. As we discussed earlier, the concepts and principles are learnt by this kind of learning. In fact, when we discuss cognitive theories, we call them as gestalt theories. Gestalt means pattern, and the pattern is visible only when you see the whole situation and understand the pattern that emerges from that situation. So, the concepts and principles have to be learnt by this kind. As we said earlier, perceptions lead to concepts, and the ideas about the tables, chairs, sky, plants, trees, whatever we can see, we are able to even have ideas about them in their absence. So, concepts are formed by grouping sensory data, by analyzing them, by reasoning, and such mental activity leads to clarity of concepts. Once we learn concepts, we combine one or two concepts to understand a principle. For example, density is mass per unit volume. Density is principle, and mass and volume are two concepts. And learning of concepts lead to learning of principles. And whether it is concepts or principles, they need a clear understanding into the organization of the components involved in them. So, this kind of learning expects the mind to be always active, perceiving the whole situation, understanding the relationship between the parts which are present, and finding meaning in that, finding or looking for meaningful patterns in that whole situation. So, mind is instrumental in this kind of learning, but once learning is there, then the benefits are that it is relatively permanent and you can use this knowledge in daily life situations. That is, you can apply this knowledge elsewhere. Examples of the theories which seem cognition is important in learning are the theories given by Piaget, Asubel and Brunner. Jean Piaget propounded the theory of cognitive development, in which he explained cognitive development in sequential stages as we grow. David Asubel gave the theory of meaningful verbal learning. He gave us tips as to how to make verbal learning meaningful, and he focused on concept formation, whereas Brunner gave as the discovery approach to learning, and then he focused on concept attainment, while Ossobel's theory gives more emphasis on the teacher's role in making the concepts clear. Brunner's discovery approach to learning emphasizes on active participation of the learner in learning by putting himself in the position of a discoverer. So students, we just understood the cognitive theories, how they lead to permanent changes in behavior, how that knowledge is useful for further applications, and how important are the reasoning and analytical skills in this kind of learning. And they are also called constructivist theories because the learner plays an active role analyzing, synthesizing, and grouping information so as to make it meaningful to himself or herself. And under this category of theories, you get to learn three theories. One, the cognitive development theory by Jean Piaget, which explains learning happening in sequential stages as we naturally grow over a period of time. So he groups cognitive development sessions into different stages based on our growth and development. We have the theory of meaningful verbal learning by David Ossobel, in which instead of explaining how actually learning takes place, he gives us tips as to how to make verbal learning meaningful by using advanced organizers, and he focuses on forming concepts in the minds of the children through graphical organizers. Then we have the theory discovery approach to learning by Brunner, in which he again gives us tips as to how we can make learning a joyful experience by placing the learner in the position of a discoverer. And inductive approach is used to make the learner an active participant, perceiving, classifying, and then toward the end, generalizing, thus facilitating concept attainment. Thank you.